Gurinder Chadha was born in Nairobi, Kenya, which was then a British colony. Her family was part of the Indian diaspora in East Africa. They moved to Southall, West London when she was 2 years of age, where she attended Clifton Primary School. Many of her films draw on personal experience of being an Indian and English at the same time, and how she dealt with the duality of her identity. So this, again, please feel free to reflect on any of your wiki narrative here.
It's good so far.
Okay, I thought this was interesting. For example, she would not wear traditional Indian clothing, and she refused to cook for her family. In her mind, having all the women in the kitchen cooking while the men sat and ate was oppressive, although it is a living part of Indian culture. Therefore, she sat at the table with men and was extremely outspoken. After graduating from the University of East Anglia, she attended the London College of Printing in 84-85 and studied as a postgraduate. Some of her films, to name some of them, along with Bend It Like Beckham, Baji on the Beach, 1993, her first film, Bride and Prejudice, 2004, Angus Thongs and Perfect Snogging, 2008. Recent projects that are mentioned that I would be curious to hear more about are an animated adaptation of the Ramayana,
yeah.
A potential sequel to Bend It Like Beckham, and a film about partition. Revisits the 1947 partition. I think I won't say much more, just a couple other quick details. She worked in television as a BBC news reporter
yeah.
at the beginning of your career. She went on to direct award-winning documentaries for the British Film Institute, BBC, and Channel 4, and released a terrific 1989 documentary, A British Butt, for Channel 4, which explores the lives of British Asians. In 1990, Chadha set up a production company, Umbi Films. Her first film was the 11-minute. This I haven't had a chance to see.
Yeah, this is all old now. This is all wrong now.
This is all wrong.
The company. Well, no, it's not wrong, but it's just... Anyway, you're done. Good.
Okay. Maybe you can clarify
Thank
for us.
You.
The 11-minute film was nice
yeah,
arrangement. That,
yeah, that was... Yes.
The relationship with Clark goes back 20 years.
Yes, which you titled, "Can a British Indian woman go to Hollywood without selling her soul?"
Yes.
Or something like that, wasn't it?
And also the Stephen, the early bit in Wikipedia about not cooking, etc., is just not true, because we all cook and we do, have got over this business of when we had to cook for the men, and it went on and on and on. That was absolutely significant at the time.
Yeah, it was half true. I refused to make chapatis.
Yeah.
That's what I thought was quite oppressive. It was
yeah.
doing all that. And burning your hands. And then, because if you were cooking, you couldn't eat, because the men got to eat them hot while you made them, and that's what I didn't like. So you're all... tell me about yourselves so that I can make the best use of our time. You're all theatre and film students, is that right?
No.
No? Okay.
I'm comparative Latin communications.
Okay.
I'm a graduate English student, so.
Okay.
I'm communications, but also theatre.
When you say communications, do you mean journalism?
No, well, I think many of us, at least some of us, are in the DIY media class, which I think a lot of us are taking for the cultural studies and communications major, which has, it's a little broad, but there's an emphasis kind of on like studying other cultures and media studies.
Okay.
So just sort of, I think, analyzing communication, and then some journalism classes are
okay, cool. Anyone else? Is it more specifically theater or?
I'm a film major.
Film, okay.
Yeah.
Directing, writing?
Directing.
Anyone else film majors? Oh yeah, we saw you last night. Directing, writing, generally?
Writer,
directors?
Writing.
writers. Okay. So what I'm trying to do is the art of a communication. I'm trying to work out what my pitch is going to be to you, because there's no point me pitching myself unless I know who I'm pitching to and what you guys are going to get out of it. So that's the first step for any kind of communication or film or whenever I would sit down to write anything. My first thing is, what am I doing, why am I doing it, and who am I doing it for? It's very important to know who your audience is in anything, in communication, in film, literature, you know, who are you writing for? Because when you're part of a diaspora like I am, you know, you don't have the luxury of just saying, I'm going to write something and everyone's going to get it, you know, because you're going to write from your own experience, and therefore, because your experience isn't the mainstream experience generally, you know, you will know that you will be, if you're going to be truthful in what you're saying, you're going to be saying stuff that a lot of people might not get, you know, culturally. And so you then have to modify and talk about what you're going to express in terms of your ideas according to who is going to get it, you know, and who isn't going to get it. And then you've got to then decide, okay, I know all the Indians will get this, but the non-Indians won't. All the women will get this, but most of the men won't. Or all the West London, Southall community will get these gags in Bend It Like Beckham, but the rest of the world won't get them. And so then the whole thing becomes a juggling act. And so I would say that, you know, a lot of people that I really admire, like, say, Steven Soderbergh, for example, you know, probably doesn't sit down and go, you know, which constituency am I going to make a film for? You know, Steven will sit down and make a film. Quentin Tarantino will sit down and write what he wants, because they write genre films. You know, they have the luxury of representing the kind of world that doesn't need to be explained. Whereas what I constantly try and do is take people who are on the margins of our society and make them feel very mainstream, so that people can't say, you know, it's an Asian film, you know, only made for Asians. That's my biggest bugbear. One of the films that wasn't mentioned in that citation there is a film that I made in the year 2000 that opened the Sundance Film Festival, and that is on television quite frequently in America. And it's a very American film, but most people don't know that I made it, because it's quite American. But for me, it was a very British film about America, and it's called What's Cooking? And it's a Thanksgiving movie, and it's generally on TV every Thanksgiving, and it stars four families on the weekend of Thanksgiving. And the four families are an African-American family with Alfre Woodard, Dennis Haysbert, and a Latin American family with Mercedes Rule, a Jewish American family with Lainey Kazan and Juliana Margulies and Kyra Sedgwick, and then the Vietnamese American family with Joan Chen. And so all these four families, we follow their particular shtick, whatever's going on in their family and how they celebrate Thanksgiving, and then you realize they're all connected in some ways. And it was my way of sort of dealing with how I thought America, but particularly LA, was, you know, on the face of it, incredibly diverse, but when I got down to it, I thought it was quite segregated. And so I wanted to make a film that featured all the communities, predominant communities that I saw, and put them all together in one film. And when we finally got the money to do it, we developed it at Sundance. We developed the script at the script lab in Sundance, and they were big fans of it. And then when we finally got the money to make it, we made it in 25 days, and all in LA, and with that great cast. And after we finished, it opened Sundance, as I said, in the year 2000. And everyone afterwards, the distributor said, it's this great film, but who's it for? You know, is it an African-American film? Is it a Latina film? Is it an Asian film? Who do we sell it to? Like, which group do we sell it to? And I was like, well, you sell it to everybody. And they're like, because it's an American film, and it's about Thanksgiving, and it's for everyone. And it was a real problem, because the business side couldn't understand. There was a great breakdown in communication, basically. In the end, it did go out. Lionsgate released it in the end. It's a very optimistic film, you know, around race and culture, and very, I think, quite an English film about it. And then years later, after I had all this grief for making a film with all these different communities, years later, a film came out that I thought was particularly weak around these subjects, but went on to win an Academy Award, and I thought was particularly dodgy around race, was Crash, which was also about different communities, but really problematic, and everything was a problem, and everything was like the white family was kind of under siege, you know, from the people of colour in that film. So that was a very interesting exercise for me early on in my career, on how to handle, how America handles race and culture. And that's when I then said, right, forget this, I'm going to go back to England, and I'm going to write the most commercial movie I can with an Indian girl in the lead. That was my thing. I just wanted an Indian girl to be the lead, but I wanted to make it as commercial as possible. And that was Bend It Like Beckham. So, and the reason I wanted to have the Indian girl in the lead was, again, it was that idea of taking somebody from the margins and making their experience mainstream. And in doing so, I ended up with something, you know, particularly authentic. If you were Asian, it's still the only, when I say Asian, I mean us, like South Asians. If you came from that background in Britain or America or Australia or any part of the diaspora, it was a very truthful, it was the first kind of real expression, I think, apart from Bargee on the Beach, my first film, where it was authentic. And it was that that journey of, you know, how you traverse different sides of your identity, but being complete. You know, you're not just this, and you're not just you're not just English over here, and you're not just Indian here. You combine them. The language combines, the music combines, the themes combine, the costumes. Everything is constantly a negotiation in Bend It Like Beckham, and as it is in Pride and Prejudice as well. And so the idea is that I make you feel like you're an 18-year-old Indian girl, and you're going on the journey with her of having to sort of follow your dream, but then have all these quite legitimate arguments from her parents' perspective, but quite ludicrous arguments from probably your own perspective of why she can't play football, you know, why can't she follow her dream? And the reason she can't follow her dream, as her parents say, is because it doesn't look nice, you know, because your sister's getting married and it doesn't look nice. We need you to start behaving like a woman now. And of course, you know, that's stupid, you know, but everyone buys it, everyone understands it, because I kind of built in what everyone thinks of traditional Indian parents, you know. So no one had any question in accepting that that would be a legitimate argument for my main character to not be able to follow her dream. So I was playing with your own images of stereotypes as well there. So in terms of communication, sometimes it's an asset to play with stereotypes if you're able to subvert them, you know, later on. So particularly with the mother, as you heard, my bugbear growing up was cooking and making perfect round chapatis, you know, because, you know, as I was growing up, as far as my mother was concerned, you're not a perfect woman unless you can cook round chapatis. And I used to hear that a lot, you know, get in the kitchen, do this, you know, what is going to happen when you get married? Your mother-in-law is going to blame me for not teaching you how to cook properly. And So that's a lot of pressure on girls growing up back then, for sure. And so I sort of subverted that by, you know, having her in the kitchen, you know, whenever she's in the kitchen, she sort of does it because her mum wants her to do it, but then she picks up the lettuce and she starts kneading it and stuff, you know, so she's sort of bringing her world in. But then at the very end, when the mother says, finally, you can go and play, when the father says, fine, go and follow your dream, you can go, you know, the mother is, well, at least I taught her how to cook, my job's done, kind of thing. So it's not to demonize that traditional perspective, but to bring it in. So everything is about bringing it into that authentic experience, you know. And it's a film that is extremely loved by a lot of people around the world. I know that because last year we did the West End musical version of the film, and it caused a lot of consternation for people who loved the film, you know, and they were quite nervous about going to see the stage show. Happily, the stage show worked out very well, and I personally think the stage show is better than the film, actually. But it stood the test of time, actually, and it's still relevant today, perhaps more relevant. And it was made before 9/11, just before 9/11. So it is a much more hopeful film around race and integration and diversity and just being who we are, and that's an interesting and enriching thing to celebrate rather than be fearful of, you know. But even though you had the seal of approval from the Asian community globally, as well as the diaspora community, I remember the review in the New York Times of the film by A.O. Scott, who reviewed the film, didn't like it at all. Because he said it wasn't the authentic voice of Asians in Britain today. And I thought that was very interesting when he said, and I talk about that because I'm thinking, so why does A.O. Scott, who is a New Yorker male, Caucasian, in New York, come across a film made by somebody who grew up in Southall, in West London, who's making a film about her own experiences based on her own family, using her own choice of music and other kind of specific cultural elements of that time. Where, how does he get to say it's inauthentic in that setting? Like, how does that work, you know? So that's, you know, obviously he was proved wrong. and I talk about it all the time, so I'm sure he was really pissed off about it whenever I raise it. But, you know, it is interesting that that is what someone like me battles against. So even though when I finally get the script there, get the funding, 5 years it took to make Bend It Like Beckham, you know, finally get it out there, get the seal of approval from my family, friends, and the community, to still have to battle that kind of point of view. You know, it's an interesting indication of how media is consumed. You know, so it's not just about going out and making what you want. It's always about who's consuming it. So for me, as a filmmaker, rather than, you know, I don't have the luxury to go out and say, I'm going to go out and make this film like this. I have to go, I'm going to go out and make this film because I want to say this, and I've got to be careful how I say it because I don't want people to misinterpret what I'm saying. That's the difference. So I can go on and on, as you've seen, but why don't we talk specifics, if anyone has a specific question. Yeah.
your newest movie.
Yes.
Coming out, right? Viceroy's House.
Viceroy's House, yes.
Is, you know, speaking of different races under one roof and everything that we've been talking about and different perspectives on things, is a partition movie, which I know is like almost like a marker of like a Indian expat filmmakers to make some form of partition movie. And it seems like a partition movie would be a departure from something you've been making as far
yes.
as like your depiction of Indian life
yes.
in Britain and like this infiltration of humor in a lot of what
yes.
you do. Are you trying to make this movie in a similar vein to the way you've made your previous
it's
films?
It's not a comedy.
It's not. It's
no.
like not going to be.
Not a lot of laughs in Partition.
Yeah, that's what I figured.
No, no it. What happened was in 2008, I did an episode of this show called Who Do You Think You Are, which you have here now as well. And I did a very early episode. And if you go onto my website, which is benditnetworks.com, you'll see the doc there. In fact, you'll see all my short films there, a lot of stuff. So my episode of Who Do You Think You Are took me on that journey back. I started in England, went from England to Kenya, to Africa, from Africa to India, and then from India to what is now Pakistan, which of course was pre-partition India and where my ancestors are from. So in that journey, it was a very interesting journey. When I finally got to where my ancestors were from, so I'd never been, I was very moved by how, when I got to the actual town and I was looking for my grandfather's house, and we couldn't find it. And I had my uncle with me who was six at the time, and he kept describing these round windows, you know, and the kind of veranda. So we thought we would know where it was, and we were walking around, and the whole town was sort of walking with us. And I said on camera, you know, I said, look, why don't we go and find the oldest person in this area and ask them where my grandfather lived, because they would know, surely. And so I said, can you take me to the elders? Where are the elders in this town? So we went down by the river, and there were a lot of old people sitting there. And I asked them, I said, did you know my grandfather, Bishan Singh Chadha? He was from Jhelum. He had a big house here. And it turns out that I went to these old men, I said, you know, how long have you been living here? Did you know my grandfather? Every single person I spoke to said, we came here in 47. We came here in 47. We came from Ludhiana in 1947. We came in 47. So it was quite shocking to me that what happened, and you see it in this documentary, I'm quite shaken by it. It was that one community upped and left, and another bunch of refugees came in and moved into their houses, you know. And so nobody was there from that time. You know, everyone were still living that life of, you know, being from somewhere else. And in the end, what happened was I decided to call my aunt in Chertsey in Surrey, and I called her and I said, you know, I said, Barb, why I'm here in your old, you know, town, and by the banks of the River Jhelum, you know, and I'm looking for your grandfather's house, you know, your father's house, you know, your house. And she said, oh, I can't remember what it was. But she said, well, what I do remember is there was a temple on the corner of the road, and we used to take money from the temple where people had left money for offerings. And then we used to go across the street to a man who sold pakoras, and they were really, he was famous because his chutney was so famous. So people used to buy the pakoras for like a cent, you know, but really for the chutney. And so where the pakora guy was, our house was just up from there. So I was like, well, that's not gonna work. Thanks very much, you know, put the phone down. And then it just so happened that as I was talking, there was a man who said, yes, there was a very famous pakora man here who left, went to India in 47, but everyone used to talk about his pakoras and his chutney. and he used to have a stall here. And it was through that story of the pakora man and the chutney that we actually found the street, and then we found the house. And then when we found the house, my uncle was very happy, but he immediately went into the horrors of what happened to people there. So that it's very short-lived. So it's like this, that dog. I'm happy, and then I'm like, oh, my God. Then I'm happy, and I'm like, oh, my God. You know, it's like that. And so that whole experience for me was, you know, life-changing, actually. And when I finally found my grandfather's house, living in England, you know, because I never really had that sense of roots, as it were, I had made London, and particularly West London, and the world of Bendy Like Beckham was my hometown. It gave me a different sense of belonging. And in fact, where I actually came from, the plains where I came from, is where Alexander the Great had his final battle at the hands of my ancestors. But when I went to leave, they all came out in the town. Everyone came out and they presented me with a shawl, and then they all threw flower petals at me and said, you know, you must come back. This is your home. You're our daughter. You're a daughter of the village. And we'll be standing here watching the road, waiting for you to come back. And I burst into tears, and it was terribly moving. And it was at that point that I said, I'm going to make a film about partition, a very humane film about partition. Because up until that point, most of the films were either, you know, extremely violent and very partisan. There had been some Indian films. There's a very nice film called Binger, which means skeleton, which had been made, which, you know, attempted to kind of understand what had been going on. And also another film called Kalapani, Black Water, which was also interesting. But I wanted to make a film that would sit in the footsteps of Richard Attenborough's film Gandhi. I wanted to make a very British film about the British Raj, but once again, populate it with people who might have been extras in Richard Attenborough's film and make them the core, the focus and the core of the story. And so that's what Viceroy's House is. So we started writing it before Downton Abbey came out, but it's a bit like Downton Abbey. But we wrote it before it. We just couldn't get the finance for a long time. But it's basically all set in Viceroy's House, which is a big Lutyens designed palace in Delhi, where the Viceroy used to live, and now it's the President lives there. Our film follows the Mountbattens from England to India as they come to hand India back to Gandhi and Nehru. Upstairs we have the Mountbattens negotiating freedom with Gandhi and Nehru and Jinnah, who of course wants Pakistan at this point, and wants India divided. So those negotiations are going on there, but we follow downstairs. We follow Mountbatten's undervalet, his butler, the chefs, Pamela Mountbatten's translator. So we follow the servants, really, as they're trying to work out what's going on with their future. And within the servants, we have the undervalet is a Hindu Punjabi, and there's a love affair between him and a translator who's Muslim, and they've known each other from before. And their relationship really embodies the emotional heart of partition. So it's very, I showed it to a British historian called Charles Allen, who's written a lot about Rudyard Kipling and very posh. He's five generations British India. His family have been there, you know, for many years. And I wanted to hear his view on it because it's a very sort of establishment. He would have given me a very establishment perspective. And it was great. You know, he came in saying that, you know, everyone had always got India wrong as far as he was concerned. And he really, he liked it a lot. He thought it was very, very powerful, very moving. He said it was much better than Attenborough's film. And he said it actually reminded him of War and Peace. It was very Tolstoy, because it was about ordinary people and royalty, you know. So I'm very excited by the film. You know, it should be out next year in time for the 70th anniversary. Mm-hmm. But it's a very humane film. I think it's very empathetic, and it's a film that warns, you know, of the dangers of politicians stoking up dissent through division and dividing humans on the basis of race, culture, religion, and what that can lead to and how unnecessary it is. So it's incredibly timely for today, you know. And when we were shooting, I had a scene, I had a refugee camp scene, and I had 1,000 extras on that day. And we were shooting refugees arriving at the camp. And the same day I was shooting was the day that the little boy was found washed up on the beach, the little Syrian refugee boy and his family. And so it was very hard, you know, because you're kind of reconstructing refugees from 70 years ago. And this is, before you come on set, that's the news that you're reading on your phone and those images, you know. And then, of course, I was editing the film in England when Brexit was happening, when there was another kind of partition of sorts, you know, happening under my eyes in England, you know. And we're still reeling from the fact that some of us, you know, that we're no longer going to be part of Europe, you know. Again, that was, you know, generally a vote cast by right-wing people based on fear-mongering, you know, of difference. And so I just think I do believe, actually, again, talking about communication, I do believe that, you know, that we are all sent here to do something. We all have a purpose. And I feel that my purpose was actually to make this film at this particular time. And, you know, something, some force, maybe it's my ancestors were sort of guiding me towards it. And that it's going to come out next year, because I really tried to make it earlier and I really wanted it to be released earlier. But it has its own will, this film, and it's saying, no, we're going to come out when we're ready. And I think it's going to come out when it has the most impact, actually. Did that answer the question? What was the question? Yes, I did answer your question.
Yeah,
yes.
So.
Someone else had a question. Go.
What does your specific process look like when you're sitting down to write a script or thinking about what kind of shots that you want in your films?
So I think the most important thing for me is, can I see it? Can I see the film? If I can't see it, then I can't do it, you know? And when I say, can I see it? Generally, I see one scene. I'll see one moment, or I'll see one scene, or one moment of a story. And then if I like that moment, then I'll build a whole story around that moment. So that then tells you what the genre is going to be. That tells you who the protagonist is going to be. That tells you when it's set. But more importantly, it's why do you want to do it? It's always, always, always the most important question every filmmaker has to ask, every writer has to ask, is why do I want to tell the story? Because unless you've got a really good reason to tell it, don't do it. It'll be rubbish. It'll be mediocre. And you'll just get frustrated because you'll have to go through lots of drafts. You have to do a lot of work to get it right. And unless you really care about it and are passionate about it, it won't happen. So that initial impulse is really critical, because that's going to, you know, and every film takes at least, I would say, 6 drafts to write. You can't write a script in less than that. You can't. And when I say draft, I mean a draft. Every draft has to move, you know, has to really shift the narrative, has to shift your idea, you know, in a very good way. I mean, if I look at films of mine now and go back to early drafts of them, you know, you can just see the work that went into it. And you could be kicking and screaming when you get notes from people, but inside you know they're right, you know. With Bend It Like Beckham, for the longest time, the story was about two girls who really wanted to play. And the coach was an old guy like Alex Ferguson, you know, Man U, right? It's an old kind of Scottish guy. And then one day we had a script meeting with this young girl, Melissa, I remember. And she said, look, I've got a really good idea, you know. She said, my best friend is Robbie Williams. Do you know who Robbie Williams is? So she said, my best friend is Robbie Williams and he really wants to act in a movie. Why don't you make the coach younger and so Robbie can play him? And I was like, I don't think so, not Robbie. But what a great idea, make the coach younger. So then you've got a love angle in this, you know. What a great idea, the women's conflict is strengthened. And that came quite late in the day, you know. And now I can't imagine it without that, you know. But that was a really good note. And so you always have to be open, you know, and you have to accept that you can't write your script and go, that's it, I'm going off and making it. You've got to show it to people, get people to read it, get people to criticize it, get people to tell you what they don't get, what they don't understand. Get people to be moved so they can't put it down. If they're not moved, it's not ready. Also, you should do a great test of a script is if you open it, any page, and take that scene that you're on, take it out. Just take that out. Does your film still work with that scene not in? Is the audience still going to be able to follow it? If they're still going to be able to follow it, then that scene shouldn't be there. So every scene has to count. So it's like a house of cards. If you take a scene out, the whole film should fall apart. So if you've got scenes in that don't do that, then your script's not ready. Because you'll end up taking them out in the edit room anyway, you know. So what's going to get you through that is your initial impulse of why you want to make the film. So obviously the Viceroy's House, it was that sense of partition, you know, that sense of being welcomed by these Pakistanis into my ancestral sort of village, you know. And but in the documentary, when I arrive in Pakistan, I'm quite bullish and I refuse to call this place Pakistan. As far as I'm concerned, it's pre-partitioned India, you know, and I say it in the car and I'm very bullish about it, you know, and quite anti-partition and anti-Pakistan as I'm going through, you know. And then by the end, I'm like, wow, this is tragic, you know, what happened. And I'm going to make a film that's going to heal that rift, you know. And so I needed to have that staying power because it took 6-7 years, you know. But it all comes down to one scene, if I can see the scene. Yeah. Sorry.
When you make a documentary like the one you're talking about, it seems like it's you frame the narrative through your own experiences. Like you are, like you, the audience follows you through your story together. Have you ever thought about like why you frame your narratives in that way, or have you thought about making a documentary film in a more objective, like where you are just the director and not an actual participant in the film? Because I'm in a documentary film class right now, I'm really struggling with the idea of like being in the film and then having like being like the talking mouth through it and like trying to walk the audience through the ideas that I'm trying to inspire in the film. Or stepping back and letting the people that I'm interviewing and the idea be the main subject of the film?
Well, the latter is more journalistic and the former is more of your personal journey. So it comes back to what is it you want to make. If it's your personal journey, it'll be more immediate. Your audience will be more immediately relating to you, like Nick Broomfield, his kind of work, you know. If you're in the back and you're letting the interviewers do the talking, then it's like a BBC doc, or it's more of a sort of journalistic doc. But they're just as powerful. I mean, you know, Searching for Sugarman is an amazing documentary, isn't it?
Super.
I mean, I was just hooked, absolutely hooked on that film.
I just watched the Fourth Estate. Have you seen that?
No.
So it's about Snowden, and
It's
really, really good. And I mean, it's all about Snowden. It's like interviews, and the journalists are kind of in the background. But the woman who made it, it's through her lens, but she's not really on the camera as much. But she asks questions, and it's about her exchange with him.
Yeah.
And so it's this almost like half step in between, where like we maybe see her in like a couple of shots, but all of the communications that Snowden has with the journalists, and like the ways they meet and the ways they interact, are all through her. So it's like it's almost like a disembodied human being. Like, you know, you see through her, but like she doesn't even have an identity. And so but with my documentary, I feel like I don't want to get in the way of the things I'm saying. You know what I mean? Like I feel like if people don't connect with me, they're just going to dismiss like the film out of hand.
Not necessarily, because then your contributors have to be compelling and your story has to be compelling. If your story is compelling and your contributors are compelling, then you've got them. You've got the audience. It comes back to communication and storytelling. And is it a story worth telling? I think that the documentary form is an amazing filmmaking form, because it can be so powerful and so emotional, sometimes in a way that drama isn't, you know. And I think that it's you as a director, you don't have to be in it, but you have to guide your audience through the story you want to tell, using other voices. But it's still very creative, because it's what you choose to ask those people and how you edit it. You know, it's still your voice. It will always be that. My first film, I'm British But, is that. I'm not in it, but I wanted to make a film about being British. So it's called I'm British But ... And I start by asking four young Asians at the time, you know, how would you describe yourself? But the four that I interviewed, was one was from England, one was from Scotland, one was from Northern Ireland, one was from Wales. So you had sort of 18-year-old Indian faces, and I'm going, how would you describe yourself? And Jabeen was Scottish. I'm a Scottish Pakistani. And the Welsh guy was, I'm Welsh, I'm from the Rhondda Valleys, and the Irish guy was Northern Irish, that's how I see myself. So you have these accents, you know, and it was shocking for people to see brown faces with these regional accents. So the storytelling started immediately. You're like, oh my God, that's a shock, I was not expecting that. And then the film then moves into the bolt, you know, what it's really about, national identity at that time. And it was the first film about being second generation British Indian. But I think that a documentary that I think is really interesting is the one on Banksy, Lee Exit. Because he started out with one idea of what he was going to do, and then it's just free form. He just goes with the flow, and you just don't, where it goes, you had no idea it was going to go there, you know. And he just went with it, you know. And he was clever to do that, because it really became, he was talking about the commodification of art, you know. And he did it so brilliant. The film did it so brilliantly, much better than if he'd interviewed anyone, you know. Yeah. Another documentary that I think is absolutely stunning, stunning piece of work, and I defy anybody to watch the first 5 minutes of this documentary and predict what's going to happen at the end. Nobody would ever predict what would happen at the end of this film. and that's the story of the Weeping Camel. Have you guys seen that film?
Yeah, we use it.
You use it? I mean, that is a film, Bloomin' Hell. That is a documentary film worth seeing in terms of form, in terms of structure, in terms of all the things that I'm talking about, cultural sort of stereotypes, everything. It's an amazing film. What's your film about?
Social media at colleges, and main just our generation right now. My thing is, like, it should make us happy. It's like a 20-minute documentary, so it's not a full.
Yeah.
I can't go that deep, but the idea is that we have so many different ways that we can communicate, and we can even specialize to the way that you feel like you can best communicate. You have a bunch of different apps or different places or different ways. But I think that it causes more issues, like it causes more miscommunication or more gaps in communication than anything else. And I want to know why that is. Like, we should be able to figure this out and communicate the best way possible,
yeah,
but we don't.
It's good, it's interesting. Cyberbullying is a big problem in England. Cyberbullying is a big thing with young kids. Definitely, that would be, as a parent, I'm very fearful of that.
Have you seen the new Black Mirror?
No.
They have a really good episode about that.
Oh, really?
That's fantastic.
The first one of the new season?
Yeah, the second one. Yeah.
And of course, the election is all on social media, right? You know, happening on social media now. No one would have predicted that, right? A few years back.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, yeah.
Thinking back about what you mentioned about the ending of Benedict Beckham, where the father kind of capitulates and allows Jess to follow her dreams of playing soccer, football, and the mother's kind of interjection. I was thinking about how that's a very optimistic view,
yes,
of this ability to reconcile these different and sometimes conflicting identities that we have, especially in a diaspora.
Yes.
I was wondering in your own personal experience or through the film projects that you pursue, what kind of vision do you have for diasporas, maybe like South Asian diasporas, but diasporas in general? Do you think it is ever possible to find a balance between those identities?
Of course, that's what the film's about. Of course, that's what Bend It Like Beckham is about. It's about showing how it is possible to have those balances. It isn't necessarily to rebel, and you can have your cake and you can eat it. That's what that film's about. She can be everything she wants to be and get to follow her dream, and the guy's gonna wait for her, you know, and her parents are happy, and she's taking a picture of Babaji with her that her mum's given her. And she's going to stay part of who, you know, she's going to remain part of her identity. She hasn't had to give anything up. She hasn't had to be punished in any way, you know. Whereas the normal discourse in media up till that point was, if an Indian girl wants to do what she wants, then her father will disown her. You know, her family will disown her because she's going off and being different. That's the predominant sort of image in the media, you know. So I was challenging that because it's not true, you know, it's not true. And my parents, you know, my dad was incredibly supportive of me, and you know, the film is about me and my dad, you know. And so I think what's interesting now is that you have a third generation of people, young South Asians around the world, who effortlessly celebrate Diwali or Eid or whatever, you know, as well as basketball and baseball and whatever, you know. There's no struggle going back and forth. It's just done the way they want to do it, you know. I think my biggest concern, though, would be language. I think it's important that whatever mother tongue you have, and that your grandparents speak or spoke, I think that would be the one thing that we all should maintain a sense of language. Whatever language our ancestors spoke, I think that's the language you should try and learn and maintain. Because ultimately, I think that's what really gives you a sense of personal depth and satisfaction. And if you're monolingual, you would never understand how important that is, because you've never known it. But if you're bilingual, you know, that sense of power you get from slipping into a different language and communicating with different people with that language is incredible. So that would be my, if I'm going to be not hopeful or cynical, it would be that people don't learn, maintain their languages. And they should.
I just have two comments and a question. I just think that's a really good point to bring up. I've been currently in the process of translating things into my family language.
Mm-hmm.
It's a really exciting sort of process. You really learn about the nuances that exist in different languages that can't carry over into English, for example.
Which language is yours?
I was born in Ghana, so my family speaks Tri.
Okay.
Yeah, so it's just different grammatical rules,
yes,
different letters. But even besides that, just the meaning of the words themselves. We have words that don't exist. You can't translate them into English.
Yes.
So it's just, it's an exciting process.
Well, it's a window, you see right there. It's a window into a 1,000-year-old heritage,
mm-hmm,
you know, and an ancestral line that empowers you.
Mm-hmm.
You are empowered because you know there aren't English words,
yeah,
that can mean what you want, you know.
Mm-hmm.
That's an empowering thing. And if you can pass that on to other people and to your children particularly as an empowering thing, then they will always know that they have an ancestral link to ideas, cultures, thoughts, music, song, whatever, that goes back, you know, in their lineage.
Yeah. And the question I had for you is, I know that you did a lot of documentary work prior to the work you did with comedic sort of films. And I was wondering about that transition, if you noticed if the transition was easy or hard between those two. And what you think, what sort of value you find in films that really invoke comedy, and how that helps people to relate to the films that you're presenting.
I think there's a lot of value in comedy when you're dealing with subjects that are traditionally described in the problematic. You know, I think nothing expresses an opinion as powerful as with comedy.
Mm.
Basically, and it's disarming, you know, comedy. It makes you relax, and then you're able to get your messages over, you know. And in terms of the transition from documentary to drama, I think everyone's first film is a baptism by fire. I mean, whatever film you're going to make, it's really freaking hard, you know, when you're a director, because you're stood there, everyone's going, yeah, now what, you know, and you're going and you're trying to be intelligent, and you're trying to feel like you know everything, and you're like, you know, but you know there are people out to get you as well, and you know, it's horrible. That first time is horrible. All you've got to be is so on top of your script and on top of what you want to do. So with my first documentary, I'm British Butt, you know, I hadn't been to film school. I'd done one short course on directing. But I knew what the message was. I knew what I wanted to say. And so I just held on to that. And I could have shot things a bit better. Things could have been prettier, you know. But I had a really good camera woman working with me, you know. And there were times when she said, oh, Gurinder, let me do this shot. And I'd go, oh, I don't think we need it. And she'd go, no, honestly, let me do it. And I'd go, oh, okay. And she was right, and it was brilliant what she had done. And now when I look back, I go, oh, God, what an idiot. I never moved the camera. I would have never moved the camera if she hadn't made me move it, you know. So you learn like that. But then the transition from documentary to drama, that was very, very tough as well. And you can prepare as much as you want, but it's really hard. And when I had done shot lists, I had the script inside out. I'd been to my locations in Blackpool. I sort of looked at venues, I kind of, you know, went there with a cameraman, I did all these drawings, everything, you know. But when it came down to it, actually being there with like all these actors going, Gurinder, what do you think if I just add this here and I do this here and blah, blah, blah. And someone over here is saying, we can't shoot that there because the sun's in the wrong place and we don't have enough money to do this like we wanted to do it. And we can't shoot at this location now because they've changed their mind. And then you've got like, who am I going to listen to first? No, actress, stick to the script. No, you know, we have to make this location work. Otherwise, you've got, you know, 2 hours to find something else. Now you have to do this. Now you have to, like, you have to deal with, talk about multitasking. Blimmin' hell, it's constant. And then it's that for 30 days or however long your shoot is. You know, it's that every day, every day. So in order to be prepared for that, you have to so be on top of your script. You have to so prep as a director because things will go wrong. And your job is to know how to make things work when things go wrong. So that actor who you auditioned, who was absolutely wonderful when you met them and in rehearsals, suddenly when the camera's there, turn into a monster because they're nervous. They're nervous themselves. And it comes out in this bizarre, kind of weird way. That's what happened to me, actually, on a film. Where this guy just turned into this like horrible, sadistic, vindictive person and kept getting everything wrong, but kept blaming the actress who was in the scene with him and kept coming over to me and saying, oh, she just keep, you know, I'm just not getting anything back from her. I'm feeding her everything and she keeps dropping the ball and I was like, are you fucking nuts? You know, it's the other way around, you know? And then I should have said that a bit better, you know, because then he then went on and kept sabotaging the scene and we end up doing like 23 takes or something. And I never do more than 4 or 5 normally, never. But I didn't have the moment because he kept sabotaging it. And interestingly, I never see him now in anything. He doesn't seem to get any work. But the point is, I was not expecting that, you know. So you have to be prepared for everything. And the first time you do it is hard. But if you've prepped, you know, that really helps. And then also, having said that, sometimes magic happens. And scenes, so for example, how many of you have seen Bargee on the Beach? Uh-oh. Could go see it. So in my first film, that I had a whole ending planned, and we were going to do it in a beautiful spot with all the Blackpool lights, and it was a very dramatic scene. But in the event, it was absolutely pouring with rain, and so we couldn't do it where we wanted to do it. It just was raining, and it wouldn't have worked. It was a really long scene, and it was the climax of the film, and so we had to think very fast. And what we ended up with was an alternative scene, which was so powerful and so evocative, the setting, you know, and then the rain somehow played into it and it just changed everything. It was marvelous. And so we sort of went with the flow. Yeah.
I guess on that note, could you talk more about the production process of a feature-length film?
Well, the production process really is about, you know, once you have a complete script, it's really about how can you now honor that script with the money that you have, you know? And what you then have to start going through that script and go, okay, what is non-negotiable in this? What is non-negotiable? Where have I got some room? You know, as a producer, one would go through and go, okay, we need this location, we need this location. Do we really need a party with 500 people, you know? Or can we do it as a dinner party with 12 kind of thing? You know, it's like you start making those decisions. And it's that, you start negotiating, basically. The negotiations start with what the writer wants, what the director wants and what the money will allow. And through those negotiations and those pulls, that's what the production process is. You know, you wanted X location, that location is hard to find, but here are some alternatives. And suddenly you go, oh, I'd always thought it was going to be a Gothic house, but suddenly an open plan modern house feels better for my character. And so then you go back to the writer and go, right, can you look at the impact of that location now on the character? So then the writer then starts having ideas, going, okay, yeah, we can do it like this, and you know, maybe it's better, and so you then, so your locations start coming into it, and then your costume designer comes on and says, well, look, this character is super rich, you know, very branded, and I'm going to need X, you know. And then you go, well, no, you're going to have to make those things and, you know, copy them. And so then, you know, then that becomes a tussle. And then the negotiation is, okay, you can have two designer outfits. So you pick which are your most important scenes and you go, right, okay. And then they then say, okay, well, if I can have two, they go back to the supplier and say, look, if we give you a credit, can we have five? You know, can you give us an extra few? And so the production process to me is always about never having enough money to do what you want and finding ways to get what you want and negotiating. But it's very important that the producer and the writer and the director are all making the song for the same film. Because at that point, if you're all making a different film, then the rot will set in. You know, and you know, it's very important that you make all, that's very clear early on that you're all making the same film.
Earlier, you said something about how you don't have the luxury of having the same kind of process that other directors have. You know, directors might be men or who might be white who have. Their voices are more of the norm of the production, and I wonder if you feel that that lack of luxury, as you said, means that you have to sacrifice some things in order to maintain, because you a lot of your films are kind of for that mainstream audience to reach a large number of people. I wonder if you have to sacrifice or like you had to tailor things to still reach that audience.
Yeah, I think there are compromises, yeah. But I think that, I think what I gain is authenticity. You know, I kind of like, I've never compromised so things aren't authentic. And I could have had a much easier life. You know, I could have easily just gone to LA and just directed, you know, lots of different kind of films, you know. Comedies and you know, the kind of films that I still get asked to do, actually, a lot of teen comedies, you know, but what I try and do is choose to make something that is going to really change people's minds and really, you know, make people think differently about women and people of color, you know. But not sort of bang them on the head with it, you know. And now, after Viceroy's House, I'm very interested in historical films and films, because what I've done in Viceroy's House is challenge, you know, the predominant history of partition, the British history. And because my film is based on top secret British documents that were withheld for 50 years. Which tell a very different story of the role of the British in partition. So it'll be quite controversial. But that is something that I am now quite interested in, is retelling history from a different perspective. And I think I'm not so concerned anymore about the mainstream thing I used to be, you know. I think what's more important now is that the work has to be good. And if people don't see it now, they'll see it later, you know. I think that's what's quite remarkable, if I can allow myself for 1 minute to pat myself on my back, is that I think that every film I've made is still relevant today. It's still totally relevant today. You know, it works. Right from Barge on the Beach, made 20 years ago. You can play that film to an audience today and it'll feel like it was made yesterday. And the same with Bend It Like Beckham, except there are some references like George Michael and, you know, there are, there's a reference to Martina Navratilova and I don't know how many people remember her, but there are references which are a bit older, but the actual subject matter and storylines are very relevant. Same with Angus, actually, with Angus Thongs and Perfect Snogging. You know, it's a very sweet film about a girl falling in love for the first time, a gawky, awkward girl who doesn't think she's very beautiful, falling in love at a time when she thinks her parents are divorcing, you know. So, I mean, I get a lot of young girls writing to me on Twitter about that, you know, because it really touches them, really moves them, and they keep wanting more and wanting a sequel. And I think the most important thing for me is to make a film that emotionally has great resonance and that an audience really relates to emotionally. Those are the films that I like, not the, you know, shoot 'em up kind of stuff, unless there's a really good emotional story.
A lot of your films involve like adapting material and then even like Bend It Like Beckham becoming a musical. So I was wondering, like, how do you choose that source material and then like how do you add your own twist for the final product?
Well, actually, you know, not that many have been adapted, only Bride and Prejudice.
But isn't Angus also based on like...
Oh, and Angus, you're right. Yes, and Angus. Oh, and Viceroy's House as well, yeah. So half, 50-50. Well, again, I think choosing material, again, it's like, does it speak to you? You know, Bride and, with Pride and Prejudice, I did that at school like everyone else, you know, and I just loved the idea of taking an 18th century classic, English classic literary novel and transporting it to India to find that the themes and everything still worked 200 years later, you know, Jane Austen's world and how women were nothing if without a man, you know, how that worked in small town India at that time. And so I think that how you choose material, it's kind of what is talking to you at that time, you know, what is it? I mean, my friend is Andrea Arnold. I don't know if you know Andrea Arnold's work. Okay, so she just won a prize in Cannes for her last film called American Honey. And she did Red Road, and she did a version of Wuthering Heights. So she's a really interesting filmmaker. She's very funny, and her attitude towards everything is fuck 'em, just do it, Gurinder, fuck 'em. You know, she's like that. You know, what do you mean it's too long? Fuck 'em. You know, she's like that. and she. But she's an artist, you know. She will spend 5 minutes on a shot of a branch banging against a window, you know, in the rain kind of thing, you know, like she's an artist. And I love her work. I love her and I love her work. It's very different to what I do, you know. But she kind of makes the same film over and over again. In different settings, like American Honey is set here in the world of motels and kids selling magazine subscriptions, I think. And her first film, Wasp, was about a young mother who's got a kid but really wants to go out to the pub to see this guy, but she hasn't got any money and the kid's crying and she sort of feeds the kid bits of sugar to keep the kid quiet and stuff. And you know, so her films are always about impoverished mothers and kids somehow, you know, and that goes back to her own childhood, you know, and her own sort of upbringing. But she manages to bring that into every different thing she does, even in Wuthering Heights, you know. She brought that in. So her choice of material somewhere, she might choose a very disparate looking material, but somehow she always finds that impoverished mother in there and child, and makes her film accordingly. And I think I think as a director, it's really you go for material that talks to you, you know, and surprisingly, you know, you're there because you're getting stuff out of your system, you know, and you've got stuff you want to express. And so until you finish doing that, you will probably keep making that same film until you're done with it. And some people are never done with it, I think.
So I'm hoping to go into public journalism, specifically radio. So I'm wondering how, at the beginning of your career, you were able to kind of get your voice out there and your pitches out there.
And what is public journalism versus
like
private?
Public radio.
Okay, NPR.
NPR. I'd rather work for like an affiliate station, but yeah, or PBS.
So you mean like newsworthy as opposed to music? Yeah. So I started in that too.
Yeah.
I started at the BBC as a news reporter.
This is where the wiki went astray, I think.
Just, what was your question specifically?
I guess like how I guess what advice do you give to people who are at the beginning of their career?
You've got to get your foot in the door. You've got to find a way and use any contacts you can to get your foot in the door. So if I were you, I would see, okay, where is the radio station that you want to be at, and start going in there on Saturdays and Sundays and helping them do whatever needs doing. Filing, going through the papers, making coffee, whatever it is. And then making yourself indispensable, and then one day coming up with a story and saying, hey, by the way, this is what's going down locally, and do you want me to do something on it? Can I do something on it? And then you borrow one of the station's tape recorders, and then you go and you cover your story, and then you come back, edit it up, and present it to the news editor. And the news editor will go, wow, she's not just good at making coffee, you know, she knows what she's doing. And then they will trust you to go out and do a story. So you kind of, it's about trust, isn't it? It's about, because the way it worked with me was we were at my college, London College of Printing, as it was called then, and on our one-year postgrad course, you know, we had two placements, where we would be sent to radio stations for a week, and we were just thrown in the deep end and told to get on with it. And so we learnt on the job. And my first interview, I remember, I had to go and do was with a man called Harry Secombe. I'm definitely sure you don't know who Harry Secombe is. Perminda will know, but no one else will know who Harry Secombe is. He was one of the original goons with Peter Sellers and Spike Milligan. And he was an opera singer as well. And I had to go and interview him. And they set me off with my tape recorder. And I was quite scared, you know. But anyway, I did this interview. And then I came back. And the interview wasn't there. I hadn't pressed the record button. I had done something wrong. I don't know what I had done wrong, you know. And so I thought, right now, what do I do? And I just immediately said, I'm just coming. And then I ran all the way back. And I said to him, I'm really sorry. Something went wrong with the machine. Like, can I just do a quick 2-minute with you? And because I'd already done the longer interview, I knew what the points were. So I just stuck my nose under his mouth and just put the mic under his mouth and just I asked him a few questions very quickly. And he was pissed off about it, but there was nothing else I could do. And then I came back and then I did it. But it's hard, you know, journalism means that you have to be prepared to make yourself look silly, and you've got to, you know, you can't be a shy journalist. You have to step out there and you have to, be heard, you know, and you have to speak up. Because you're speaking up on behalf of everyone else, you know. So there's no such thing as a shy journalist. So my advice would be is to actually just start going out and looking for stories. Start going out looking for stories now and sell them to your local NPR station. Whatever, any local story, anything that's happening, just go and do it. You can do it now on iPhones and stuff, you know. Literally start doing it now. And even to this day, you know, I was in Paris and I did this film, Paris Je T'aime, which is like 10 directors who all make a 10-minute film about Paris. And so I was there doing that. And I was there at the same time when there were riots going on all over Paris, you know. And there were sort of sirens going past my hotel room. And my immediate reaction was to say, shall I get up? Shall I call the BBC? You know, because I still think like a journalist, you know. And I'm like, I'm here, it's happening outside my hotel. Shall I call the BBC, you know, and do a news story, you know? Or should I tell them what's going on? Or should I, you know, because I'm here right now. So I often envisage if I'm in a situation where something's going down, there's a part of me that always thinks I should get in touch with the local news or the BBC news because I'm there. So it never leaves you.
We have time for one or two more.
Yeah.
So just kind of pulling that conversation back to Bender Life Beckham, some people read Jess and Jules' relationship as a queer love story, and I was just wondering about what your interpretation of that interpretation of the movie is.
Yeah, well, I think that, you know, we wanted to blur a lot of boundaries in that film, you know, which is why we also have Tony there who comes out. And I think that the idea is that everybody at that age is trying to be who they are, you know, and, you know, and all the possibilities are there to be anything, you know. And so just while she's sort of struggling to define herself with her parents, you know, so is Jules, you know, and so is Tony. And I think that, you know, I probably think that Jules is bisexual, you know, but her mother is so kind of anti it, you know, that she probably hasn't sort of built up enough courage yet to kind of go for it. But I'm sure if I ever did a sequel, that would probably is what will happen.
There are rumors of a sequel. Is that a possibility?
No, I think it's too long now, yeah. Besides, I don't think Kira would do it. Yes.
Thank you for being here. I'm very happy to bring my class here today also. This is called Do-It-Yourself Media.
Right.
I'm also a television producer. I produce documentaries.
Okay.
Mostly about race and culture issues.
Okay.
Could you say a few things about agency in terms of who has the right to speak or say certain things, specifically about race and culture, identity?
Mm.
Like, for example, Scarlett Johansson what's it called again?
Ghost Michelle.
In Japan was.
Lost
in Translation, right? So
yeah.
She plays a white,
yeah,
American foreigner in Japan. And I grew up in Japan, so.
Okay.
You know, so and then currently she's playing a Japanese, right?
Oh,
so,
is she?
Yeah.
Which
is really odd, right?
Oh my God.
So she plays a foreigner, now she plays a Japanese. So in terms of agency, when you're casting,
yeah,
how do you fit that in?
Where is she playing Japanese?
It's an adaptation of a Japanese anime series.
They're doing that?
Ghost in the Shell,
yes.
Yeah.
Oh, okay, so it's her voice.
No. It's a live-action adaptation of animation.
Oh, my God. But she doesn't look Japanese.
Nope, she does not.
No, she does not.
She looks like Scarlett Johansson. Yeah.
So, and it's a big problem.
Is the character Japanese?
Yes.
Correct.
Very much so.
Okay.
Now, the peripheral characters are Japanese. Now, and as a...
So is she doing all that business?
What's that?
Is she going to do that taper eyes and all that?
I don't know. No. She, yeah. So, I mean, obviously that's a big problem in Hollywood.
Yeah.
And all over the world. So if you could say a few things about...
Well, you know, the thing is that Hollywood is an industry. You know, the business, it's a business. It's an industry. Who was it who just recently got in trouble?
Ralph Fiennes' brother, Joseph Fiennes, is playing Michael Jackson.
Oh, yes, that's right.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
And he says, why can't you use your imagination? But you could also say, when a...
he can't dance, though.
He's the one who's got the role.
Really? Oh, I'm shocked at that. That is really fucking stupid. Oh my God.
Yeah.
That was it, Ridley Scott. That's right. The last debacle in this, Ridley Scott, in Exodus, wasn't it? He cast Joel Egerton, and he said that there were no Arab actors that fit the part. Mm-hmm. You know, there was sort of outcry. So the thing is that Hollywood needs stars, you know, and a film, their perception is that a film only happens, you know, because of the stars attached. And what they mean is when they want to make a film with a person of colour in it, you know, their stars aren't big enough, really, you know. And so they'll cast a Caucasian star. And the thing is that 9 times out of 10, it just backfires anyway. So it doesn't make business sense.
Right.
So I know with Ridley Scott, there was a big outcry about it and the film really bombed, Exodus, right? So one would think that, they wouldn't do this. I know with Miss Saigon, you know, that was a huge outcry. And recently, Miss Saigon came back to the Western stage, and they cast it was cast appropriately, you know. So there is some progress on that front. But I think, one has to remember that Hollywood is an industry, you know. I mean, I just found out the weekend box office of my friend's film, Miranair's film, Queen of... Katwa didn't do very well, but then there wasn't much publicity about it. And it's such a lovely film. It's a great film set in Uganda about a girl who wants to be, who's really good at chess and becomes a chess champion. And the only reason the film got made is because of a studio exec who's African who pushed for it to happen. And so he wasn't able to follow it through, I guess, in terms of the marketing, you know. And besides, it's a weird time to release a film like that, too. I mean, you have to release that kind of film during the school holidays. So, obviously, I think they probably wanted to dump it or something, you know. I think that I find that when it comes to race and agency, as you say, I think there's a lot of fear, you know, in America. And it's industry versus fear, really. Because the industry side likes to think they're colorblind, you know. But then when you have the whole Oscar So White debacle last year, every single studio went into production on a film, with around race, you know. And so now you have a lot of films this year, you know. So I think that they're just fearful and don't really know how to deal with it, to be honest with you. But I do think it's quite shocking in this day and age, because you see, to me that would backfire. And also to me, I know that Scarlett Johansson must be asking herself that question.
Well, she can say no, also.
Exactly.
Right? I mean, she has.
Yeah, we've come a long way. Exactly.
Sure.
But at least Joseph Fiennes is saying, use your imagination. That's quite funny that he's saying that.
Yeah.
He's saying, why not, you know?
Yeah, exactly. But he doesn't say, people don't say when a black actor plays what was originally a white character, then nobody says, well, use your imagination.
James Bond, for example.
Sorry?
Like James Bond.
Or
yeah,
Spider-Man.
Exactly. Yeah.
Spider-Man.
Yeah, but except that in England, though, J.K. Rowling, mm-hmm. who has to be, you know, one of my favourite women in the whole world, they cast a black Hermione,
mm-hmm.
and there was a massive outcry in England for the stage production mm-hmm. of Harry Potter, and everyone in England was like upset about this, and they couldn't understand. They were like, "God, she's destroying." You know, our memories of the books and of the... And she says, well, in the book, I never say what she is. You know, so why are you thinking she's like she is in the films? In the books, I never say it, you know.
Right.
And so if I want to cast a black girl, I will. And I think this girl was the best actress to audition, you know. So she went and took it head on. And then in the end, people sort of said, well, we don't buy it. We don't buy what you're saying. We don't, you know, we don't agree with you. And she said, you know what? Fuck off. She said, don't come and see the show. If it affects you that much, just read the books. Don't come and see the show. I'm not asking you to come and see the show, but it's my right to cast who I want. So she definitely shifted that agenda. Definitely. So I guess it's small steps, isn't it? I mean, come on, we all know what's right and we all know what's wrong, you know.
But so as an independent filmmaker, right?
Yeah.
So this class, the DIY media, you know, we talk a lot about specificity and wedge marketing and reaching your audience and added value, things like that. But but in the end, agency and authenticity, the word that you used earlier, is really a key component.
It is, but it also means that if I want to make authentic films with Indians in, mm-hmm. you know, it means that I struggle because I don't have necessarily a big pot to choose from in terms of actors who mean something. So that's why a lot of my films are often marginalized. And then when they break out, you know, they break out, you know, in spite of people not really picking them up to be more successful. I mean, you know, in Britain, I'm one of the few British filmmakers whose films consistently have, you know, not only made their money back, but make money. But you wouldn't know that from the way people talk about other British filmmakers. You know, there are plenty of British filmmakers who are lauded who've lost loads of money at the box office, you know, but not me necessarily. So I think that I think that it would be hard for me to cast someone who wasn't appropriate, you know. But I think, you know, I'm not the industry, you know, the mainstream industry would do that. But then you do get other films, you know, there was the film The Cedar, or was it Snow Falling on Cedars?
Uh-huh.
You know, that was very authentically cast. But he was an Australian guy, the director of that. You had Come See the Paradise, but that wasn't a big hit, if you remember. They had Dennis Quaid carrying that film. But then you have films like Joy Luck Club, you know, which were massively successful.
True, true.
And all very authentically cast. I think it's down to the executives, you know, who are in charge at the time. And how they feel. And Memoirs of a Geisha.
Uh-huh.
She was Chinese, wasn't she?
Well, not Japanese. No, Japanese. Yeah.
Oh, she was Japanese. Okay.
No, the actress.
Yeah.
I don't think she was Japanese.
No, she was Chinese.
Yeah.
But
so,
they all look the same to them.
I mean,
though,
you
don't
know,
they?
we can get you know, going down that line of us. You know, what is specific, but.
Yeah. Well, I think you have to understand that. Hollywood is an industry, you know, and not be debilitated by that, and then and not measure yourself against that, and pursue your own ideas and talk about your own work,
mm-hmm.
you know, proudly, because at the end of the day, you know, I'll be dead and gone, you know, soon, you know, well, not soon, but you know, I will be, and but you know, my films will carry on, you know, And, you know, people go, oh my God, this is what they were thinking in the 90s, wow. Or last century, this is what people used to think, or whatever, you know. And I think that at the end of the day, only the work matters. Only the work matters. Look, I'm talking to you all about a film that was made 15 years ago. Mm. You know, when I made it, I didn't think it was going to be as successful as it was. But it shifted, it changed race relations in Britain.
Yeah.
Absolutely changed race in Britain, that film, mm-hmm. you know. Mm-hmm. It made us part of the mainstream, you know, because everyone talked about it as a mainstream film. I got a letter from Tony Blair, which I was very excited about at the time. Not so excited now. You know, I actually got given at the time, I did a talk for one of his MPs at Waterman's Art Centre near Southport. And I'd agreed to do a benefit screening for this MP, Labour MP. And she then came up, presented me with a bottle of House of Commons claret.
Mm.
And said, you know, this is a gift for you. And it was, you know, to Gurinder, loved your movie, best wishes, Tony Blair. So I was like, oh my God, how exciting. And then on the other side, it was like, I loved it to Gordon Brown, you know, when he was his deputy, when they were all good friends, you know. And I thought, oh, I'm going to treasure this bottle of claret. It's going to be worth a lot of money one day, you know. And from there, for 15 years, I've had it. I've kept it. It's in my cupboard at home. And I've seen the value of it go. And now I look at it in the cupboard and I go, oh, my God, I should just smash it now. But it's got Tony Blair's signature on it.
That's great.
But, you know, who'd have thought then that Tony Blair was going to fall in our estimation, you know, right, like he has, you know. So I think that ultimately, though, you know, it is all about the work. The work matters. And whatever you set out to do, and you'll do it yourself. You know, whenever you go out and cover a story, whenever you go out and write a script, whenever you go out and direct something, I think you need to think, in 5 years' time, will this still matter? Mm. Will people be talking about this? Does it matter? Am I making a change? Am I changing somebody's life for the right reasons by doing this? You have to aspire. You have to aspire high because you have the power. The power to communicate, you have the power to change people's minds, you have the power to mold the next generation. You know, you have an enormous amount of power if you can communicate as a journalist or as a filmmaker, you know, as a writer. It's a big responsibility, mm-hmm. and you shouldn't take it too lightly. Honestly, you've been chosen to do it. I believe that. If you choose that path, you have been chosen. You didn't choose it. Someone chose that for you. So use your skills well. Use your power well. Because it's not going to be there for long. You know, we all die very quickly by the time... I mean, I've made, what, 7 films, you know? And it's gone so quick, you know? So, yeah, use your time well.